The Last Stand of Fox Company, A True Story of U.S. Marines in Combat, by Bob Drury and Tom Clavin. Narrated by Michael Prichard. Copyright 2009 by Bob Drury and Tom Clavin. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Grove Atlantic Incorporated and was produced in the year 2009 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Prologue. November 2nd to 4th, 1950. Only the officers knew that the dark railway tunnel a few hundred yards up the road marked the official entrance to the Sudong Gorge. The enlisted men didn't carry maps, but they sensed it. Over the past several miles, the broad rice paddies and vineyards, the neat rows of persimmon trees, and the tiny farmhouses with their empty ox carts had disappeared and had been replaced by the stark granite hills of upper North Korea. "Engine territory," one of the Marines said. A few others forced a grim laugh. To most of the Marines, hostile terrain had begun as soon as they'd crossed the 38th parallel and started the long slog north. Still, that dark tunnel looked ominous. They were Fox Company, and just before they rounded the sharp bend in the road and humped into the tunnel, they spotted Dog Company engaged in a firefight, maybe half a mile to the west, along the slopes of one of the Broken Tooth Mountains. They found this strange. By this point in the war, more than 4 months since Kim Il-sung's invasion of South Korea, and 6 weeks after the United States' successful counterattack at Incheon, the North Koreans could be counted on to cut and run at the first sign of Americans. But Dog Company seemed to be meeting serious opposition. And some of the Marines in Fox Company began to wonder if the regimental commander's warning hadn't been the usual shinola. Perhaps the Chinese had indeed crossed the Yalu River and entered the war. In any event, that was Dog's problem, at least for the time being. And as Fox emerged from the north end of the tunnel and into the dusk, the sheer hills on either side of the company loomed high and tight. It was a good place to call a halt, and the outfit's enigmatic commander, Captain Elmer Zorn, decided to bed down the column for the night. One of the actions that had Zorn's men often glancing at him warily was calling in an airstrike uncomfortably close to their own position. On another occasion, he mistakenly radioed for artillery support on Fox Company's own coordinates. The sun was dipping over the stout, charcoal-colored western hills, and an eerie gray mist shrouded the forbidding taller mountains to the north. Fox was still 4 miles south of its objective, the tiny crossroads hamlet of Sudong. But Zorn's men had slept hardly at all for 2 days. The CO considered the odds. With the 1st Battalion out in front and the 3rd Battalion following close behind, he expected no trouble. Before assigning night watches, however, Zorn did take one precaution. He ordered the leaders of his 3 rifle platoons to have each of their men take a good long look at 4 Marines from the 1st Battalion who had been bayoneted in their sleeping bags 24 hours earlier. Their cold bodies, laid in a small depression between a creek bed and the dirt road, were still wrapped in their bloody mummy bags. Sergeant Earl Peach of the 2nd Platoon spat. He'd seen worse on Tarawa and Iwo. Still, he never got used to the sight. As darkness fell and the temperature dropped, Fox was strung out perhaps 400 yards along the road, with sentries snaking up the overhanging ridgelines. All the scuttlebutt about the Red Chinese spooked the company, and scattered small arms fire and an occasional howitzer report punctuating the cold air from up ahead didn't help. At midnight, a rumor started that a North Korean tank was prowling the area, and this put everyone's nerves on edge. But there were no incidents. Not long after sunrise, a few Marines spotted the column of soldiers exiting the tunnel, 75 yards south of their bivouac. These were definitely troopers, maybe 200 all told, marching in twos with a brisk, jaunty step. Far too crisp for them to be the weary Marines of the 3rd Battalion's rear guard. And they were wearing unfamiliar uniforms. But Fox Company had been relieving numerous South Korean infantrymen all along the road north, and these were most likely more of the same. The Americans had taken to calling their allies Rocks, after South Korea's official name, the Republic of Korea. Corporal Alex Bob Mixon, a forward artillery observer attached to Fox from the 2nd Battalion's 81mm mortar unit, was the first to see them, and the first to sense that something was not right. They were no more than 40 or 50 yards away when he hollered, "Halt! Who goes there?" The answer was a fusillade of automatic weapons fire. Mixon dived behind a rock. When he emptied the clip of his carbine into the two columns, they broke to both sides of the road and assumed firing positions. Mixon was impressed by their discipline, a trait heretofore lacking among most of the Reds he'd encountered. Now Mixon could hear Captain Zorn running toward him, yelling, "Hold your fire! Friends! Friends!" But the bullets snapping over Bob Mixon's head were far from friendly, and as he shouldered his carbine and squeezed off another clip, he watched Fox Company's civilian interpreter tackle the captain and pull him down into a ditch on the side of the road. By now the Chinese, as Mixon had concluded they were, had set up two heavy machine guns on either side of the tunnel entrance and were pouring fire into the company's mortar squad strung out along the creek bed. Half a dozen Marines fell instantly. Mixon was debating what to do when a helmet popped up beside him. It was Sergeant Peach, who had crawled through a culvert under the road. "Gotta keep 'em off those mortar men," Peach said. He began picking off enemy soldiers with his M1. Mixon reloaded and joined in with his carbine, aiming especially for the machine gunners. When they had both run out of ammunition, they fell back to Captain Zorn's ditch. The captain was on the field phone, ordering several fire teams to take the high ground and secure the main ridge line on the east side of the gorge. Simultaneously, a large unit of Chinese broke off from the gunfight in the valley and began scrabbling up the steep hills. A BAR man from the 2nd platoon watched them. Maybe 100 or so soldiers, no more than 300 yards away, climbing a parallel peak. They were hopping along the ridge line like jackrabbits, and he was so impressed with their agility and the sharp cut of their uniforms, hell, even their backpacks looked impossibly squared away, that he initially thought they might be some hotshot Marine outfit he didn't recognize. But when his squad reached the top of the ridge, they were stopped in their tracks by the disconcerting sight of a lone Chinese officer standing atop a giant boulder and dragging casually on a cigarette. At the American's approach, he flicked his butt in their direction, jumped from the rock, and disappeared over the reverse slope. The Marines had been too stunned by his presence to shoot him. When they reached the boulder, they found field telephone wires running down the cleft in the ridgeline. A couple of men unsheathed K-bar knives to cut the wires, and someone said, "The bastard's been watching us the whole time." From the top of the hill, the Marines of Fox Company could again see Dog Company fighting for its life far to the west. Not a few men wondered what the hell was happening. Meanwhile, down in the creek bed, one of the wounded Marines cried for help. A Navy corpsman squatting next to Captain Zorn made a move to rise from the ditch, but the company's gunnery sergeant shouldered him back to the ground. Because of the Chinese machine gun fire, any attempt at rescue seemed futile. But Sergeant Peach decided to chance it. He scooped up the corpsman's medical kit and took off. Zorn and the few Marines behind him opened up with covering fire. Peach made the creek bed. The Americans near Zorn whooped with admiration. Peach was unlashing the medkit from his shoulder when he was stitched across the face by machine gun fire. The top of his skull seemed to lift off his head, as if pulled by invisible wires. Captain Zorn ordered a counterattack, and the remaining Chinese fled up the hill, leaving perhaps 50 of their dead strewn across the road. The rest of the day became a long, tense standoff, as the Marines and Chinese regulars attempted to outflank each other on the ridgelines. Sniper fire and the occasional pop of small mortar rounds echoed off the hills. Zorn radioed division and then ordered Fox Company to dig in for the night, as he and his staff laid plans for a dawn attack. But by sunrise the Chinese had vanished, and the Marines of Fox were left to wonder if this disappearance was permanent, or if they had just taken part in the opening salvo of World War III. The Hill. Day 1. November 27, 1950. 1. The Americans moved in slow motion, as if their boots were sticking to the frozen sludge of snow, ice, and mud. They had been dug in on this godforsaken North Korean hillside for less than 48 hours. Yet when the 192 officers and enlisted men of Fox Company, 2nd Battalion, 7th Regiment, were ordered to fall in, gear up, and move out, their mood became almost wistful, or what passed for wistful in the United States Marines. Just past sunrise, Dick Bonelli, a 19-year-old private first class, crawled from his foxhole, stomped some warmth into his swollen feet, and took a look at the new line replacements. Most of these men, boys really, were reservists who had joined the company within the past couple of weeks. He knew few of their names.
"Greenhorns," he spat. "Don't know how good they had it sitting up here fat and happy."
The words came out in a voice so gravelly you could walk on it, all the more menacing because of Bonelli's tough New York City accent. The sky began to spit snow as he packed his kit and continued to gripe. Corporal Howard Kuhn, Bonelli's 20-year-old fireteam leader from the 2nd Squad, 3rd Platoon, shot him a sideways glance. Fat and happy. Two men from the outfit had been wounded on a recon patrol the previous night. But Kuhn, a taciturn Muscogee Indian from southern Michigan, let it slide. Bonelli had been in a foul mood since Thanksgiving, when his bowels were roiled by the frozen turkey he had wolfed down outside the battalion mess. At first, the holiday feast, served 3 days earlier, had seemed a welcome respite from the greasy canned bacon, lumpy powdered milk, and gristly beef turdlets that the mess cook seemed to specialize in. But at least a third of the outfit had picked up the trots from eating the ice-cold candied sweet potatoes, sausage stuffing, and young toms smothered in gravy. Served hot, of course, but flash frozen to their tin trays by the time the Marines took the meals back to foxholes that felt more like meat lockers. Elongated strips of frozen diarrhea now littered the trench latrine. Bonelli threw his pack over his shoulders.
"Off to kill more shambos in some other shithole for God, country, and dugout dug," he said.
A couple of guys choked out a laugh at his scornful reference to the Supreme Allied Commander, General Douglas MacArthur. With his jet-black pompadour, high cheekbones, and often broken Roman nose, Bonelli could have been cast as one of the quick-draw artists stalking Gregory Peck in The Gunfighter, the hit movie being shown on a continuous loop in the holds of Navy troop ships steaming from California to Northeast Asia. This was apt. Cowboys versus outlaws was an overriding American theme in 1950, almost as fashionable as cowboys versus communists. It was the year when Alger Hiss was convicted and Klaus Fuchs was arrested for spying for the Soviet Union. and an obscure senator from Wisconsin named Joseph McCarthy propelled himself into the headlines by charging that the State Department employed more than 200 communist agents. It was the year President Harry S. Truman authorized the construction of the first hydrogen bomb, and Germany had settled into separate countries. It was the year when Winston Churchill warned in the House of Commons of a looming World War III. And across the Atlantic, more than 100,000 U.S. National Guardsmen and reservists were recalled to active duty. Half a decade after the hottest war in history, the world in 1950 was on the cusp of George Orwell's Cold War. Though Orwell had died 10 months earlier, his phrase was destined to live on, not least in the craggy mountains of North Korea. But Dick Bonelli and the enlisted men of Fox Company were not much given to geopolitical strategy. Theirs was a tactical clash, not even dignified, as they noticed, by an official declaration of war. It had been designated, instead, a United Nations police action. It was a dirty little conflict in a faraway Asian country the size of Florida, a hermit kingdom that most Americans couldn't even find on a map. The fighting was on foot and deadly, hilltop to hilltop, ridgeline to ridgeline. Whatever small plateau of land the Americans controlled at any given moment constituted their total zone of influence, and was ceded again to the enemy once they had departed. The deadly Browning automatic rifle, the BAR, was the weapon of choice for the strongest Marines, and one of Fox Company's BAR men was Warren McClure, a young private first class from Missouri. Just that morning, he had been introduced to his new assistant, Roger Gonzalez, a reservist and private first class from Los Angeles. Gonzalez had been in Korea less than a week. "Forget the flag, patriotism, and the Reds," McClure told him. "We never own any territory. We're just renting. You're out here for the fight and the adventure." Gonzalez hung on the old-timer's every word. McClure was all of 21. Dick Bonelli wouldn't have argued with McClure's advice. He had been born in Manhattan's Hell's Kitchen and raised in the Bronx, and fighting and adventures were a way of life for him as the son of an Italian bus driver growing up in an Irish neighborhood. He had even beaten up one of his high school social science teachers who had dared suggest that Bonelli was descended from an ape. His truculent attitude had caught up to him 16 months earlier, when he was arrested for borrowing a stranger's car and was offered two options by the Bronx district attorney: the armed forces, or an indictment for grand larceny. Bonelli was a tough kid, and the Marine Corps, which by 1950 had become America's warrior elite, was a natural fit for him. The farm boys and cowhands of the Army's nascent Ranger units could still remember their origins as lowly mule skinners. The Navy's SEALs were still only envisioned by former World War II frogmen, and the Green Berets did not yet exist. But the Marines, there was an outfit. Then, as now, it was the frontline Marine rifleman who preoccupied the strategists and tacticians at Quantico in Virginia, the acclaimed warfighting laboratory. Specifically, how to infuse in every man in every rifle company the Corps' basic doctrine that battle had nothing to do with strength of armaments or technology or any theoretical factors dreamed up by intellectuals. Instead, according to the Marine Corps manual, warfare was a clash of opposing wills, an extreme trial of moral and physical strength and stamina. To its acolytes, the Marine Corps was no less than a secular religion. Jesuits with guns, grounded in a training regimen and an ethos that relied on a historical narrative of comradeship and brotherhood in arms stretching over 150 years. In short, if a man wanted to be part of America's toughest lineup, he had best join the institution that had fought at the halls of Montezuma and Tripoli, Belleau Wood and Guadalcanal, Tarawa and Iwo Jima. And Dick Bonelli certainly wanted to fight. He may have been pushed into the Corps by the law, but now, as he put it, he would
run through hell in a gasoline suit to find the gook party.
From the beginning of the war, American soldiers had been approached by Korean children who pointed at them and said something that sounded like "me gook." Actually, the Korean word gook means country, and the children's use of the phrase "me gook" was probably a complimentary reference to the United States as a beautiful country. However, among the Americans, the term gook soon took on a pejorative sense, meaning any Asian, especially any enemy Asian. Vanelli's constant refrain since the landings at Incheon had been,
"When do we get the gook party started?"
It was now Fox Company's catchphrase after every ambush and firefight.
"Hey, Bonelli, big enough party for you?"
The men of the company had attracted their share of fighting. Admittedly, 1 month earlier, they had endured a 10-day sail to nowhere around the Korean Peninsula. They had boarded flat-bottomed landing ships tank, LSTs, at Incheon on the west coast, and had steamed to an unopposed landing near the mined seaport of Wonsan in the northeast. To their humiliation, they had been beaten there by a flight carrying Bob Hope and his USO dancing girls. Yet this peaceful debarkation at Wonsan was the exception. Almost from the moment they waded ashore, the Marines of Fox Company encountered bloody, if sporadic, resistance along their 200-mile slog north. The newspaper columnist Ambrose Bierce once noted that war was God's way of teaching Americans geography. And now obscure dots on the North Korean map with names like Hungnam and Hamhung and Kotori were proving his prescience. The company had lost good men in each of these places, and nearly a month earlier, during a 2-day firefight at the Sudong Gorge, the 7th Regiment encountered its first Chinese. They'd beaten them decisively, but afterward, Fox had buried another 8 Marines. Fox Rifle Company was only a tiny component of the 1st Marine Division, which was itself just part of a pincer movement organized by General MacArthur. From his headquarters, 700 miles across the Sea of Japan in occupied Tokyo, MacArthur commanded 2 separate United Nations columns moving inexorably north toward Manchuria. The columns were separated by 55 miles of what MacArthur described as the merciless wasteland of North Korea's mountains. In the western half of North Korea, near the Yellow Sea, the U.S. 8th Army, augmented by South Korean, British, Australian, and Turkish troops, more than 120,000 combat soldiers in all, was overstretched in a thin line running from Seoul deep into the barren northern countryside. Farther east on the Korean Peninsula, MacArthur's X Corps, 35,000 strong, was also marching north, with eventual plans to meet the 8th Army somewhere along the Yalu River, the country's northern border with China. Commanded by the Army's Major General Edward M. Almond, X Corps was a fusion of 2 South Korean Army divisions, a small commando unit of British Royal Marines, and a regimental combat team, put together from the U.S. Army's 7th and 3rd Divisions. There was also the 1st Marine Division, the oldest, largest, and most decorated division in the Corps. The Marines considered General Almond as somewhat too adoring of MacArthur, and there was a tacit understanding among seasoned military observers both on the ground in Korea and back in Washington, D.C., that this fight belonged to the 1st Marine Division. The 1st Marine Division was commanded by Major General Oliver Prince Smith and consisted of 3 infantry regiments, the 1st, the 5th, and the 7th, which were supported by the 11th, an artillery regiment. Each regiment consisted of about 3,500 men, 3 rifle battalions, each of approximately 1,000 men in three rifle companies of anywhere from 200 to 300 men. All told, General Smith had about 15,000 of his Marines along 65 miles of a rutted North Korean road that ran north to an enormous man-made lake the Americans called the Chosin Reservoir, a Japanese bastardization of the Korean name Chungjin, or the Frozen Chosin. MacArthur's plan was to sweep North Korea free of the communist dictator Kim Il-sung's fleeing North Korea People's Army all the way to the Yalu River. He boasted to reporters that once his troops had mopped up the last stragglers and diehards of Kim's army, the American boys would be home for Christmas. This would be a nice, short little war wrapped up in 5 months. But even after the North Korean capital, Pyongyang, fell to the dogfaces of the Eighth Army, the Marines of Fox Company were hard-pressed to reconcile their own reality with MacArthur's optimism. As Fox's crusty platoon sergeant, Richard Danford, had muttered after the brief, brutal scuffle at Sudong, "If these are the goddamn stragglers, don't even show me the diehards." Danford, at 27, had a lot of hard bark on him, and he had learned through experience to trust little that came out of any general's mouth, particularly an army general in Japan and away from the front line. He once heard a saying by a French politician that war is too serious to be left to the generals. Now there was a guy who knew what he was talking about. Danford figured that the Frenchman must have once served as an enlisted man. Fox Company had caught only the ragged edges of the battle at Sudong. Other Marine companies took the brunt of the attacks by what were described as a few Chinese diplomatic volunteers who had sneaked across the Yalu River to aid the Koreans in the campaign against Western imperialism. Nonetheless, every American involved in the fight had been staggered by the disregard for life the Chinese displayed. Tales spread among the regiment of how an American machine gun emplacement could take out half an enemy infantry company, and the remaining half would still keep charging. Someone even suggested that the Corps put together a special manual for fighting the drug-addled Oriental. Moreover, paramount in every Marine's mind that November was a frightening question. Where were the rest of the Reds? And when were they coming? A month earlier, the Foreign Minister of the People's Republic of China, Chou Enlai, had issued a public warning to the Americans to keep their distance from the Yalu. Mao Zedong, the Chinese leader, backed up his minister's threats by massing several armies of the Chinese Communist Force, CCF, on the far side of the river. This actually further inflamed MacArthur's atomic ego. After the landings at Incheon, in a meeting with President Truman on Wake Island in the Northern Pacific, MacArthur brushed off Mao's move as diplomatic blackmail. "We are no longer fearful of their intervention," he told Truman. "If the Chinese tried to get down to Pyongyang, there would be the greatest slaughter." Perhaps. But despite MacArthur's insistence that only a few Chinese had voluntarily crossed the Yalu, barely enough to make up a division, there were rumors running through the American lines that several CCF armies had in fact begun infiltrating North Korea in mid-October. These reports were not lost on the anxious Marine General Oliver Smith. Smith, a cautious man, had never shared MacArthur's expectation of a quick victory in North Korea. Privately, he scoffed at home by Christmas baloney. He was certain that his Marines would face strong Chinese resistance west of the Chosin Reservoir as they pushed toward the Yalu. In a private dispatch to the Marine Corps Commandant General, Clifton B. Cates in Washington, a back-channel communication that enraged MacArthur when he learned of it, Smith pleaded for someone in high authority who will make his mind up as to what is our goal. Smith apologized to Cates for the pessimistic tone of his letter, but explained that to obey MacArthur's and Allman's instructions to push on with the 1st Division's flanks so exposed,
was to simply get further out on a limb. I believe a winter campaign in the mountains of North Korea is too much to ask of the American soldier or Marine, Smith wrote. And I doubt the feasibility of supplying troops in this area during the winter or providing for evacuation of sick and wounded. I feel you are entitled to know what our on-the-spot reaction is. Smith noted in his letter that about half his fighting men were young, unseasoned reservists. Despite the fact that when the 1st Marine Division had been hastily deployed to Northeast Asia, all the division's 17-year-olds were culled from the ranks to remain in Japan. Moreover, in many cases, reservists with summer camp experience, either one summer with 72 drills or two summers with 36 drills each, were deemed combat-ready by dint of this training, despite the fact that they had never been to boot camp. Before Sudong, no more than a handful of Marines in Fox's company had ever seen a Chinese soldier, and the others probably wouldn't have been able to tell the difference between a Chinese and a North Korean. Corporal Wayne Pickett, who at 21 was another of the old men in Fox's, was, however, one of the few. He had served a tour in Shanghai as a seagoing Marine in 1947. And he told his buddies that their firefight at Sudong was a picnic compared with what he'd seen and heard at Shanghai. He added that they would sure as hell recognize a full force of fighting Chinamen when they met it. For one thing, the Chinese were taller, Pickett said, and a hell of a lot more robust and better armed than the human scarecrows still loyal to Kim Il-sung. Pickett also warned that the Chinese soldiers were veterans of Mao's civil war, and their fighting ability was not to be taken lightly. And the rocks damn well know that, he added. As Pickett's stories spread, a few Marines in Fox's company thought back to a scene they had witnessed a couple of days after Sudong. While moving north, the outfit had passed a Republic of Korea Army unit marching south with a single Chinese prisoner. The Americans didn't have much faith in the fighting ability of most ROKs to begin with. But at the time, more than a few Marines were shaken by the overt fear their South Korean allies exhibited at the mere presence of this shackled Shinagen, or Chinesu, in their midst. Nonetheless, by the time Fox Company lined up for its Thanksgiving dinner, they hadn't seen a hostile Chinese in the 4 weeks since Sudong. The Chinese had simply disappeared, and a buoyant feeling was slowly returning to the company, a sense that Christmas Day 1950 might indeed be celebrated in dining rooms and at kitchen tables in Duluth and San Antonio and Pittsburgh, in Los Angeles and Miami and the Bronx. 2. During the first 6 months of the Korean War, its ebb and flow had pushed Fox Company to a remote, windswept tableland 210 miles north of the 38th parallel, which had been established as the border between the two Koreas after World War II. The locals called it Kaemakkowan, the roof of the Korean Peninsula. In the 16th century, the first European missionaries and traders painted a romantic portrait of this sawtooth terrain, likening it to a sea in a heavy gale. For weeks, Fox had been traversing this knotted ground, up one desolate mountain, down the next, hiking cold and wet toward the Yalu. And these exhausted men did not compose any lyrical odes to the place. Some Marines in Fox's company had come to consider the situation a cruel game, and with nothing to lose, they began playing it themselves. At dusk, they would search the compass points and pick out the highest, coldest-looking hills. Then they would wager on which one they would be sent to hold for the night. Now, on the morning of November 27, 1950, they were on the move again. The knoll Fox was abandoning after Thanksgiving rose west of the village of Hagaruri, which to the Americans resembled nothing so much as an old Klondike mining camp
with its dilapidated houses packed close around newly erected canvas tents. The village was situated atop a muddy, triangular plateau whose southern terminus was a broad field crammed with more rows of American tents, supply trains, and fuel and ammunition dumps. On the edge of this clearing, marine engineers operated 5 Caterpillar tractors day and night under fixed floodlights, chugging to and fro, carving a crude airstrip out of the frozen earth. Scuttlebutt had it inside Hagaru Ree's defensive perimeter that Fox was preparing to move up a winding, 12-foot-wide dirt road the Americans had designated Main Service Road NK-72, or simply the MSR. Most of the men believed they would be traveling the 14 miles north to another tiny village, Udomni, which was in a floodplain between 2 rivers and the northwestern tip of the Chosin Reservoir. There they assumed they would rejoin the bulk of their 7th Regiment and its commanding officer, Colonel Homer Litzenberg Jr., a stubborn, impatient Dutchman known as Blitzen Litzen. Litzenberg's regiment was part of a force of 8,400 that, along with most of Colonel Raymond Murray's 5th Regiment and 3 artillery battalions of the 11th Regiment, was the tip of X Corps' spear. 8 miles to the east, across the reservoir, 2,550 GIs who were part of 2 Army battalions were also positioned to storm north, locked and loaded, anticipating MacArthur's order to commence the final push to the Yalu. But as Fox Company assembled outside the battalion command post in Hagaru Ree, word filtered down that they were headed not to the reservoir, but instead to Toktong Pass, 7 miles north, midway between Hagaru Ree and Udomni. There, they were to dig in along one of the lower ridgelines of the highest mountain in the area, the 5,454-foot Toktong San, which overlooked the MSR where it cut through the pass. It was the only road into or out of the Chosin. This order to essentially babysit at a bottleneck did not sit well with Fox Company. In fact, the Marines could not comprehend it. The North Koreans had been on the run for 10 weeks, and by this stage in the war, even Hagaru Ree was considered a safe enough rear area to have its own PX, even if its stock was limited to Tootsie Rolls and shoe polish. Moreover, Marines did not retreat, so the very idea that Litzenberg's and Murray's rear supply route needed guarding was ludicrous. The enlisted men of Fox would have much preferred to push on farther north to Udomni, lest they cede bragging rights to some undeserving outfit. Baker Company of the regiment's 1st Battalion was already boasting about the carpet of corpses it had left in the hilltops, gorges, and draws around Sudong. This was more than nettlesome, particularly because, in Fox's opinion, Baker Company wouldn't know its ass from a hole in the ground. Naturally, the Marines blamed this strange turn of events, as they blamed most things, on MacArthur's inconceivable decision to place X Corps under the overall command of an Army general, Almond. Rivalries among the Marines themselves may have been spirited, if good-natured. By contrast, there was no love lost at all between the Corps and the Pogue Doggies, a pejorative slang term Marines originally had applied to anyone with a soft rear area job, but which by now was used to describe any dogface in the Army, a branch of the service that the jarheads deemed so thick with deadwood it should have been declared a fire hazard. This was another reason for Fox Company to add Allman's name to their already long shit list. The gouged, dome-topped Toktong San, eroded by time and Korea's bitter winters, is a southeastern spur of the ancient Taebaek mountain range. This stunted cordillera hugs the Sea of Japan from the Chinese border well into South Korea, and it reminded some of the Americans of the Appalachian Range. The young Marine recruits from the East Coast on their way to Camp Pendleton in California had been particularly impressed when the troop trains had climbed the Appalachians, that is, until they glimpsed the Rockies from the flat plains of Colorado. After they crossed the Rockies, the puny Appalachians, like the scrubby piles of granite they gazed up at now in North Korea, had diminished in their memories. Compared with the Rockies, the Taybaks seemed more hills than mountains. This impression changed when they had to climb one. Recruiting posters showed the typical leatherneck as tall, square-jawed, powerful, and mature. But the majority of the men of Fox were baby-faced boots who had only recently started to shave. On leave, they preferred malt shops to gin mills, and the opposite sex came in three flavors: mom, sis, and an exotic type that existed only to be lied about or ogled. Their train trips from towns and cities across the United States to Pendleton, near their debarkation point to Japan, had for most of them been their first time away from home. Now, in Korea, with their gaunt profiles reflecting the rigors of constant battle marches, they suggested not so much a picture of American samurai as a scraggly crew of teenage pirates. The onset of the North Korean winter had been harsh. They were frozen and exhausted when it snowed, and they were frozen and exhausted when it didn't snow. An unremitting wet gale blew constantly. The Marines took to calling it the Siberian Express and glazed every rock with ice. Their knees, knuckles, and elbows were covered with bloody scabs from continually slipping on treacherous slopes, and their feet and hands were always numb. Hours during the day were hardly noted, as they set their body clocks only by daylight and darkness. And aside from a vague awareness that Thanksgiving had just passed and Christmas was coming, many had no idea what date it was, much less what day of the week. Moreover, because canteen water had to be thawed over campfires, stateside notions of hygiene had been abandoned from almost the moment they had set foot on Korean soil. A twig often had to do for a toothbrush, and they could barely lay their heads down for the night in an abandoned hooch without waking up with a scalp full of lice. Most had given up trying to wipe their runny noses with anything other than the sleeves of their filthy uniforms, and anyone who grew a mustache soon had a revolting mass of frozen mucus layered across his upper lip. They bitched and groused, but they never shirked a command, remaining true to the Latin motto above the eagle on the Marine emblem: Semper Fidelis, always faithful. And so, just past noon, while Fox Company mustered in the village of Hagaru-ri, Lieutenant Colonel Randolph Lockwood, commanding officer of the 7th Regiment's 2nd Battalion, summoned his subordinate, Captain William Edward Barber, Fox Company's new CO, for a trip in the company jeep to scout Toktong Pass. Barber was a decorated World War II veteran who had assumed command of Fox 3 weeks earlier at Kotori, after his predecessor, Captain Zorn, was transferred to division headquarters. Barber was a tall 30-year-old with a broad, nondescript face, an odd round nose, and thinning brown hair. In mufti, he might have been taken for an actuary rather than a commander of a Marine rifle company, and few encountering him could have guessed that he'd been a star college baseball and basketball player. Yet, despite his unremarkable exterior, his physical appearance reminded a few men in Fox Company of a younger version of the irascible banker Henry F. Potter in the movie It's a Wonderful Life. The captain carried himself with the demeanor and bearing of a hussar. This may have been a result of the long bareback rides he had taken as a child through snow-packed Appalachian hollows when he ran errands on the family's one plow horse during winters. Barber had grown up in the rural town of DeHart, Kentucky, near the Ohio River, in a homestead hit hard by the Depression. His father, Woodrow, was a subsistence farmer and sometime carpenter. His mother, Mabel, grew vegetables in a small garden behind their house. Young Billy, the 8th of 10 children, was a shy, sensitive child who devoured every book he could borrow from the local library, particularly volumes on history and current events. He was a precocious student, the valedictorian of his high school class when he graduated at age 15, and early on he determined that his four brothers and five sisters needed his assistance, both educationally and financially. He always managed to find time to take his siblings aside and help them with their reading and writing. And even when he moved on to the nearby Moorhead State Teachers College, he relished returning on school breaks to join his father and brothers plowing and harvesting the family's small cornfield. When the Barbers killed a hog for special occasions, such as Thanksgiving or Christmas, it was always Billy who volunteered to dress the carcass. In the late 1930s, Barber sensed a world war approaching, and while studying at Moorhead State, he joined the Marine Reserves, pointedly without informing his parents, who considered the military as a second-class career for such a smart young man and would have preferred him to become an educator. In 1940, following his sophomore year, he further distressed his mother and father by quitting college and shipping out to boot camp at the Marine Corps recruiting depot on Parris Island in South Carolina. He was generous to a fault, and his brothers and sisters looked forward to his numerous letters, as he never forgot to include a few dollars, often doubling the amount when he sent birthday cards. When he returned home on leaves, he made sure to bring small mementos from his travels for everyone. Barber was what the Marines called a Mustang, an enlisted man promoted to officer whose leadership skills had been honed in the ranks as opposed to the saddle. He proved to be a crack shot, and after boot camp he was retained at Parris Island as a marksmanship instructor. A year later, in 1941, feeling confined on the tiny base, the Marine Corps was only a small force of 18,000 men when he enlisted, he volunteered for the Corps' new paratroop service. He proved so adept at falling from airplanes that he was again ordered to stay on as an instructor, now at the Naval Air Station in Lakewood, New Jersey. From early on, his superiors recognized something special in his character and marked him as a candidate for promotion. After the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor, Barber was transferred to the Marines' 1st Parachute Regiment in San Diego. It was there, at a USO canteen, that he met and fell in love with his future wife, Ione. They were married in October 1942, the same year he was promoted to sergeant. Officer candidate school soon followed, and in February 1945, having received his commission, he landed with the 5th Marines on Iwo Jima as a 25-year-old lieutenant leading a rifle platoon. Through the awful attrition of the campaign, he wound up a company commander. On Iwo, he was shot in the hand and was briefly evacuated when he began bleeding from both ears. He was diagnosed with a severe concussion, but he recovered and returned to the atoll, where he rescued two wounded Marines pinned down by enemy fire. For this, he added the Silver Star for gallantry to his Purple Heart. He remained a company commander during the post-war occupation of Japan, and in early 1946 he was posted to Camp Lejeune in North Carolina as a recruiting officer. Then he was promoted to captain and transferred to Altoona, Pennsylvania. He was living at the Marine Barracks there, training reservists, when, on June 25, 1950, Kim Il-sung's 90,000-man army, led by 150 Soviet-made tanks, swarmed across the 38th parallel. Kim's forces routed the South Koreans and their American protectors and captured the capital of Seoul in 3 days. Halfway around the world, Bill Barber followed early news accounts of the war with a mixture of fascination, disgust, and sadness. His fascination stemmed from a Marine officer's professional appreciation of the fighting spirit of Kim's ill-equipped but courageous and tenacious forces. The Koreans, geographically isolated, hemmed in by Russians, Mongols, and Japanese, had for centuries accepted their role as shrimps among whales. It had actually made them tougher. They reminded Barber of the Imperial Japanese forces he had fought in the Pacific. On the other hand, he was disgusted by the disorganized retreat of the unprepared U.S. Army down the peninsula. And he was saddened by the unusually high number of Marine Company commanders, most of them fellow veterans of World War II, who were killed as the North Korea People's Army swiftly occupied 95% of the country. By the time of MacArthur's audacious counterattack, the amphibious landing at Incheon, just southwest of Seoul on September 15th, Barber had received his orders to report to the front. He was en route as Fox Company embarked on the long sail around the peninsula and landed at Wonsan. He caught up with them just south of the secured village of Kotori. Barber did not endear himself to Fox's careworn veterans when he arrived from Japan. His uniform was starched and spotless. Even his dungarees were pressed. And one Marine noted that he was all dressed up like a well-kept grave. But he believed that a Marine's appearance should reflect combat readiness, and he was appalled at his new outfit's slovenly demeanor. He told several fellow officers that they reminded him of one of Pancho Villa's bandit gangs. He introduced himself by directing his platoon leaders to order all the Marines in Fox to field shave with cold water, clean their filthy weapons, and prepare for a conditioning hike at 0600 the next morning. He also spread word to knock off the fairy tale talk about being home for Christmas. "Just what we need," said the veteran Private First Class Graydon Davis. "Some candy-ass captain who wants us to troop and stomp. What in hell is this war coming to?" Nor did Barber's official introductory remarks the next morning before the hike go over well. He told his assembled company that there was a lot of war left to fight, and Fox was damn well going to be prepared to fight it. He spoke in a tangy drawl. "I may not know about strategy," he said, "but I know a lot about tactics. And frankly, I'm a hell of a good infantry officer." As the old man's coming aboard speech ended and the assembly broke up, Dick Bonelli remarked to a group of buddies,
"Somebody ought to tell this guy that Marines are more show me than tell me."
Barber overheard him but said nothing. He liked grumbling Marines. The more they bitched, the harder they fought. Plus, as an enlisted man, he'd been a griper himself. Fox would learn soon enough that behind the new CO's prickly and fastidious exterior was a saltiness earned on the black sand beaches of the South Pacific. 3. Although Barber had only just met his superior, Lieutenant Colonel Randolph Lockwood, he already admired Lockwood's moxie. The story of how the pudgy, pink-cheeked, pipe-smoking officer had held his own during his first meeting with Blitzen Litzen 3 weeks earlier had circulated swiftly throughout the 7th Regiment. When Lockwood, a genial graduate of the Naval Academy and Harvard, arrived at Kotori to assume command of the 2nd Battalion, Litzenberg had taken in his preppy demeanor with a thunderous stare from his big coal eyes.
"I see you're overweight," Litzenberg said by way of introduction. "Nothing like a mountain campaign to get a man into shape," Lockwood replied. His voice was a little too cheerful. "I'm a hard taskmaster," Litzenberg said, glaring at him. Lockwood smiled. "That's what I've heard, Colonel." No one else dared talk to Litzenberg like this, and the exchange immediately elevated Lockwood's status among Litzenberg's underlings, if not with the colonel himself. Now, as Barber and Lockwood's jeep ascended the road to Toktong Pass, the weak sun burned the haze off mountain meadows dotted with thatched roof huts and empty ox carts standing nearby. This was a sudden new world, big, muscular, and edged at its margins by brooding storm clouds. It was not lost on either Marine that mountain warfare was alien territory for an amphibious force trained and accustomed to fighting on beaches.
Both men had received sketchy reports of enemy contact earlier that day at the Chosin, probably involving Chinese units that had forded the Yalu, and this gave their 7-mile drive an uneasy tone. In fact, as they snaked farther away from Hagaruri and up the steep slopes toward Toktong San, two things struck them with foreboding. The first was their topographical maps. These were outdated, adapted from old Japanese documents, and nothing on the charts seemed to match the contours of the terrain. Peaks loomed high on the wrong side of the road. Valleys opened where there should have been hills, and snow-covered foot trails meandered next to streams, frozen solid and marbled with blue ice, that should not have existed. More ominous was the absence of refugees. Since the landings at Wonsan, the Americans had encountered emaciated North Korean civilians on nearly every road and donkey path. But this morning, the MSR was deserted even by the small groups of bedraggled boys who usually begged for candy and chewing gum. Barber had done his homework, which included reading a translated copy of Military Lessons. The propaganda tract the Communist High Command had disseminated among its troops. This pamphlet had been found in the pocket of a dead Chinese NCO at Sudong. After grudgingly noting the tactical superiority of U.S. tanks, planes, and artillery, it declared, "Their infantry is weak. These men are afraid to die, and will neither press home a bold attack nor defend to the death. If their source of supply is cut, their fighting suffers, and if you interdict their rear, they will withdraw." Barber had also scanned intelligence files prepared by the South Korean Army interpreters at HQ in Hagaruri. Several local farmers had been interviewed, and they reported that the area's abundant game had lately been spooked out of the narrow mountain vales around the Toktong Pass. It was as if something was moving around in there. He suspected it was a shitload of Reds. Upon reaching the switchback where the MSR looped east to west at the apex of the pass, Barber and Lockwood dismounted before a steep, broad eminence on the north side of the road and began climbing in the shadow of Toktong San. They were at 4,850 feet when they reached the 80-yard-wide crest of the promontory, a shoulder of the big mountain. The effect of being cut off from the sea by mountains to the west, east, and southeast had extraordinary consequences. The raw, wet wind screaming out of the Arctic and across the Manchurian plain, and then funneling through the pass, was the fiercest either man had ever encountered. The area around the Chosin Reservoir was said to be the coldest place in Korea, and the fallow terrain was the only ground in the country where rice could not be grown. The local peasants knew to expect an average of 16 to 20 weeks each winter, when the average temperature never rose above 0 degrees Fahrenheit. And Barber could not help wondering how drastically this cold would reduce his company's combat efficiency. The hill they stood on loomed above two narrow valleys and occupied an area about the size of 3 football fields. At the top of the hill, on the northwest quadrant, the ground extended to form a narrow saddle, 75 yards wide and humped like a whale's back. This land bridge, which ran 300 yards, fell away sharply on both sides and ended at a large rocky knoll. Above and beyond the rocky knoll, a string of higher, serrated, rocky ridges ran another 1/3 mile like a gleaming white staircase up the looming bulk of Toktong San. Except for the narrow saddle, the hill was well separated from the other heights in all directions by slender, snow-covered valleys. The basins to the east and west stretched a bit over 200 yards across, with the western depression bisected by a deep ravine running lengthwise up to the edge of the saddle. The wider southern vale, level bottom ground with brown tufts of alpine grass dotting the snow like miniature haystacks, ran nearly 300 yards. These valleys separated the hill from three similar tree-skirted knolls to the east, west, and south. Delineating the base of the hill, adjacent to the road, was a sheer-cut bank, 10 feet high by 40 feet long, where the MSR had been chiseled out of the heights 18 years earlier during the Japanese occupation of Korea. Past this steep wall, neat rows of fir trees, 4 to 5 inches thick at the trunk and perhaps 40 feet tall, climbed 2/3 of the way up the slope. These immature dwarf pines, also planted by the Japanese as part of an emergency reforestation program, were spaced 8 to 10 feet apart. Above the tree line, the crest of the hill sported small patches of gnarled brush that pushed through the hard-packed, knee-deep snow. The undulating hilltop was also broken by countless rocks and colossal boulders. Two of the largest boulders, a pair of tall, flat-faced rocks, 8 feet high by 6 feet across, dominated the northwest corner of the peak at the beginning of the saddle. They resembled giant dominoes. The hill's main, central ridgeline rose to 225 yards above the road at its northeast corner, and dipped to 175 yards high at the northwest peak, where the saddle began. A secondary, catty-corner ridgeline bisected the hill from the lower, southwest corner, and petered out at the tree line. The entire hill was pocked and pleated with depressions, erosion folds, and a few old bivouac bunkers and foxholes that had been rocketed and napalmed by the Americans as Litzenberg had ascended the pass on his march to Udomni. A shallow gully, 20 yards wide, ran straight up the middle of the hill from the road to just beyond the trees. In the lower, southeast corner, below the fir tree plantation, a freshwater spring flowed out of the mountains despite the freezing temperature. Near the spring, two abandoned huts had been built several yards back from the road. These structures were about 10 feet high, with dirt floors, low-pitched roofs, and doorless openings at either end. The larger hut, which ran parallel to the MSR, was perhaps 12 by 20 feet and was divided into two sections. It looked as if it had been a subsistence farmhouse. Half of it seemed to be a kitchen. The slightly smaller hut, sitting at a right angle about 10 yards up the hill behind the main house, retained a strong odor of farm animals and had a large grain storage bin at its south end, closest to the main building. As Barber and Lockwood climbed back down to their jeep, the new commanding officer of Fox Company was already conceptualizing his defensive perimeter. His Marines, Barber told Lockwood, would defend Toktong Pass from this hill. He would align his men up the gentler eastern grade, across the crest, and down the steep western slope in the general shape of an inverted horseshoe, the reverse U position taught at Quantico. The road would close the two piers of the horseshoe, with the breadth of the oval perhaps 155 yards wide from east to west. After Lockwood accepted his plan, Barber asked to remain at the pass while Lockwood returned to Hagaru Ri. Lockwood reluctantly agreed and told him to expect the arrival of his company within the hour. Back in the village, however, Lockwood could find no vehicles to transport Fox Company up the MSR. At 2 p.m., word passed among the men that they would be hiking the 7 miles up the icy, muddy, glorified goat trail. One Marine noted in his journal, "Now we gripe openly and vociferously." The footsore Marines of Fox Company were not happy to be lugging more than 60 pounds each of weapons, ammo, and gear up the road. In addition to the standard-issue Garland M1, an 8-shot, clip-fed, semi-automatic rifle that weighed about 10 pounds, they carried carbines, 45-caliber sidearms, light machine guns, mortar barrel tubes and plates, bazookas, entrenching tools, boxes and bandoliers of ammunition, cartons of sea rations, satchels of grenades, heavy down sleeping bags, command post and medical tents, medical supplies, a radio and field phones, half-tent covers, and personal items such as books, extra socks, souvenirs, and a bathroom kit. Some had 38 caliber pistols, gifts sent from home, in shoulder holsters under their armpits. They were also swathed in bulky layers of winter clothing. Each man wore a pair of windproof dungarees over a pair of puke-green wool trousers and cotton long johns. A four-tiered upper body layer of cotton undershirt, wool top shirt, dungaree jacket, and navy-issue, calf-length, alpaca-lined hooded parka. A wool cap with ear flaps and visor beneath a helmet, wool shoe pads and socks worn beneath cleated, rubberized winter boots or shoe packs, and heavy-duty gloves covering leather or canvas mittens. Some men had cut the trigger finger off their gloves. This late in the afternoon, no one was confident of reaching Toktong Pass before dark. But luck struck when the company's forward artillery observer announced that he had scrounged transport from the commanding officer of Howe Company, the 2nd Battalion's 105mm howitzer unit based at Hagaruri. The Artie boys had agreed to lend Fox the 9 trucks they used to lug their big guns. "Bring 'em back with the tanks full," one of the artillerymen joked. And at 2:30 p.m., the company was ordered to saddle up. As men climbed onto the open flatbeds of the 6x6s and squeezed into the seats of the company jeep, some Marines riding on the hoods, more than a few freezing men wondered where their new commanding officer was. 4. If Fox Company was suspicious of its new spit-and-polish CO, he too was leery of them. Following the landings at Incheon, the company had taken heavy casualties during the Weijongbu campaign north of Seoul. Then, on the push north to the Yalu as winter set in, frostbite had become more effective at thinning the outfit than the random roadside ambushes. By the time Barber assumed command at Kotori, nearly half the unit consisted of fresh boots and most of its officers were as new to Korea as Barber was. The company was nowhere near its full strength, and one day on the road near Kotori, Barber watched aghast as an entire squad failed to take out 3 fleeing North Korean soldiers no more than 200 yards away. On Iwo, this would have been a job for one Marine. Barber's defining character trait may have been his rigorous self-discipline, and he expected no less from the men under his command. Thereafter, he instituted a routine of daily rifle practice on makeshift ranges, using cans cadged from the mess tents as targets. This did not sit well with weary, frozen Marines who could see warming campfires and smell coffee roasting while they lay prone in the snow firing at bacon tins. Oddly, however, despite the punishment, no one considered Barber a mean-spirited leader. Unlike many Marine commanders, he took pains to explain the reasons for every reprimand he issued. And in this case, the regimen worked. Before long, each man in the outfit had improved his marksmanship impressively. Similarly, during skirmishes along the trek to Hagaruri, Barber found hands-on opportunities to teach his new line replacements how to call in close air support, register artillery rounds, and fire the mortars at night. Sometimes, to his men's perplexed amazement, he would simultaneously break out in a full-throated rendition of the Marine Corps hymn. All in all, Barber felt that by the time Fox Company set off for Toktong Pass, his training on the run had not only improved his unit's fighting skills, but brought the men together as a cohesive team. They would need to be. Barber had studied Sun Tzu and was also familiar with the military writings of Mao Zedong, who had been strongly influenced by Sun Tzu's ancient but still practical strategies during the recent Chinese Civil War. The reason we have always advanced a policy of luring the enemy to penetrate deeply, Mao had written in On Protracted War, is that it is the most effective tactic against a strong opponent. Now, alone on a vital pass, Barber took another look at North Korea's unforgiving mountains. Who was out there? And in what strength? The Chinese had been fighting in these hills for millennia, and Barber again considered Sun Tzu, who had set down his ideas in the 4th century BC. If Mao was still following those precepts, the odds were that the 1st Marine Division was being lured into a trap. And, Barber noted, his company, his first command in Korea, was right in the thick of it. At 3 p.m., the convoy carrying most of the 3 rifle platoons and the headquarters staff of Fox Company left Tagaru Ri.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.